Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, in case you're catching us for the first time, this show happens every weekdays, Thursdays, 10 p.m. here on Urban TV. Or better still, you can catch the repeat on Saturdays at 8 a.m. Saturday, that's in the morning, yeah? So make a date and learn something about how you can improve your business. Okay, talking improving business, let's talk you then through how to make money for this week. And in part two of Violent Kukunaki's story, she runs a poultry farm in Wakiso that we did visit. This week, we're talking how relevant bookkeeping is for a poultry business person. You can't say you know all the numbers of, you know, hens that you have in the farm, how many trays of eggs are collected per day, how much is put in the food. But after you're done watching this segment, you'll learn that bookkeeping is actually more than just knowing how many trays of eggs are collected in a day. This is how to make money.
Where it seems that there is no way, and you pray. I'm a very firm born again.
Ah, that's good. Okay. Yeah. Let's talk about bookkeeping that you mentioned earlier. Just how important is it for any entrepreneur?
What are you doing if you don't have books?
It's my business anyway. I can.
What are you doing? You don't know. You don't know. You don't know what you're doing. You don't know how many birds you have. You don't know how many eggs you've collected. I have good employees, but if you have bad ones, they will teach you what business is without books.
Are they your relatives?
They will rob you. No, I don't know them. I don't know where they came from. A friend sent, they're from different regions.
So it's important to have the bookkeeping aspect, but it's more important to have employees that trust you and you can trust them. How do you deal with yours? I saw you have a farm manager that I think I should be talking to as well. How do you make yours trust you and deliver, whether you're on or off-site?
You must know the business as the farm owner so that it removes any temptation of them wanting to cheat you. I know the number of eggs I expect.
In a day,
in a month,
in a week.
And I check. I don't just let them write anything and not check. I check the books every day, or almost every day.
Wait a minute. So every day you know the numbers of...
Yes.
You note down.
They note them down and I check in the books. If a bird has died, I want to see its carcass. Otherwise, see, I've learned a lot over the years. Mm. There's a gentleman that came and immediately for him thought he's going to start selling. And he indeed was selling the birds and I didn't know. Yeah. So it reached the time of off-laying. You expect to have like 900 birds, you have 600. Especially if you're rearing in the deep litter system. Mm. The deep litter system is where the birds are reared on the floor.
That's tricky, and I think it's more common.
It's the most common.
Yeah.
After the free range system.
Yes.
Because it's cheaper. But I keep telling farmers, if you rear birds in the battery cage system, I know each cage has 4 birds, that is the standard. If there are 3, I want to see where the third one has gone. Either it should be in the sick bay, or if it has died, I want to see its carcass before you dispose off of it.
Mm, that's accountability.
So without, and every that dies, every bird that dies, you record it. Every egg that is laid, you record it. That is for accountability. So if you, sir or madam, you are in the business, you think everything is in your head, hey, you're in trouble. Even when you get the money, you must have a receipt book. You must have where you have written down the trays that have been sold.
Yeah.
At what price? Such that even if someone is doing the selling for you, the eggs that have been sold, the eggs that have been got should tally. And the money in their account should also tell you the money that you have. You know, everything should match.
Okay.
And without that, really, there is a problem.
Okay.
And when there's a problem, you won't know.
Mm-hmm.
Really, there are some basics. Yeah? I've gotten 5 trays of eggs. Maybe each is 12,000. That is what, 60,000?
Mm-hmm.
is 60,000. If I'm going to buy a sacket of medicine, maybe it is 10,000. 60 minus 10, I'm left with what? 50,000. There are some basics.
So you make those deductions, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Then I personally send my books maybe quarterly or annually to an auditor to audit me. So I'm accountable also to someone. Mm. So if you run your business like it is money from the pocket, I'm telling, first of all, you're not going to grow. Mm. We have people here with 1 million bags. I envy, I want to, I aspire for that. So I can't be here seated comfortable. I have 3,000 bags. Eh? And or maybe you have 250 buds, but you're not doing anything that will take you to 1,000 buds, to 4,000 buds. And you can't do it when you're keeping the money and spending it, and you're running it like it's a home. Even homes should be run under certain financial principles if they are to grow.
That's right. Yeah. But let's talk about marketing. How do your eggs go out? And as you answer that, maybe you talk to us about how much you spend on feeding the birds, let's say on a daily or weekly.
Our eggs are sold mainly to wholesalers.
Why is that so?
It is easier for me. Like I said, I stay home. Hmm. The business is not big enough for me to put marketeers that they'll go looking for market. So people come, they want eggs, you want 10, 50, 300 trays. That's what we do. We give you the eggs. We sell to you the eggs. So for now, that is the marketing strategy. Whoever comes and wants eggs, as long as it is not, I want one tray. Mm. Those ones, you know, we sell to you. Then, cost of feeding. For now, we spend about 3.5 all the birds per 9 days.
That's in the million.
Yeah, 3.5 million. 3.5 million every about 9-8 days.
That's a week and about there. Okay, so the obvious question that most probably every listener wants to know or watch is, so what are the challenges?
Challenges. Now, for me, I would say right now, my challenge is lack of information on finance. And generally, a lack of information for other farmers would be a challenge. So if you don't have information, that is when you get the real challenges of sickness. You don't know how to prevent the disease, but if you knew, you wouldn't get that challenge. That's why I'm saying the main challenge is lack of information on disease management, disease prevention, vaccination, when to to deworm, how often to deworm, what to do after deworming, all those things that would keep the farm running with minimal costs. Now, when you don't know all that, where to get good feed, which is the biggest input. So if you do not know all that, that's when you're going to get challenges of, you hear from other farmers, not me, I will take myself out of that category. From other farmers, the hens are always falling sick. Why? You're giving them bad food from people who mix food and put in soil. Everyone sells soil. You're feeding your, who eats soil and produces? Not even a person. So what do you expect from the birds? You're not cleaning for the birds. You know, some place, some farms ridden with flies, really. So what do you expect? So really, just a general lack of knowledge that can very easily be rectified.
Okay. Right,
for me, that is it.
Oh, cool stuff. So as we come to the end of this conversation, what would be your message to those aspiring poultry managers and more so women that want to be successful in business?
My message is join the business. It is lucrative as long as you do, as you follow the principles. It is for disciplined people. And when you do join, actually before joining, find a successful mentor. There are many people who masquerade as farmers, briefcase farmers. I risk sounding very bad, but some people forever have a job and forever will get their salary and put it in the business. That's not a business.
Mm.
A business should be self-sustaining.
Mm-hmm.
So for you, you think you have your birds there, but you're sustaining them with external funding.
So a business that can't sustain itself is as good as close and go home.
Unless you want to put in the measures that will enable it to be profitable, just close and go home. And keep your job and save your money. Maybe invest in bonds, treasury bills, whatever.
Mm.
Yeah.
So it's important for you to have some money,
yes,
and start. But along
the
way.
That it is self-sustaining.
Along the way.
Yes. So start, identify a mentor.
Mm.
A successful poultry farmer or whatever business it is you want to do. But if it's poultry, a successful poultry farmer that will hold your hand and you go together.
Mm.
And ensure that you call them, because sometimes you think your mentor is going to look for you. No, they don't know. They also have their own issues.
Mm.
So look out for them, look for them, engage them, tell them I've faced this challenge, I've seen the bird. Maybe the bird has a comb that is blue. The comb is this red thing.
Mm-hmm.
Today I've seen it is blue, what could that be? And the earlier you detect those problems, the easier it is to manage them.
Yeah.
And you move on. Yes.
Okay. Your final say should be on your prospects for the future. Where do you want to see yourself, like they say, in 5 years?
Hey, my dreams are huge. I keep telling my employees and I tell the world, I admire people with those big number of birds. Those people with 1 million birds, 40,000 birds,
mm,
one day. That will be Nesting Farm Enterprises. And hopefully I will be along with the team that we are with now.
So running through that story, one of the questions that Violet asks is, if you do not have bookkeeping in your business, then what are you doing? And I tempted to say, it's my business. Oh, yes, so it is your business, but if you don't follow the principles, some things are obvious, you will fail. So it doesn't matter what percentage of the business you own, there are basic things that you must do right. Because something like bookkeeping will help you know how much has been invested in the food, how many birds are left, how many are sick, how many trays you've collected, what are the employees doing? Because you see, some employees are so smart in that they will track you in that point when they think you're so busy and they will take advantage. So if they can take records, then you can compute all that. At the end of the day, week or month, you know this is what we spent in our operations, these are the losses we cut, and these are the profits. So if we are adding this amount of money, this is what we shall recoup in this period of time. I don't need to say more, I guess. Yep. Let's talk a personal finance tips for this week. And like I said earlier, with the whole conversation of loans, it looks like some people, because they are so much into need, they rush to get the money and sometimes never really paying attention to the different things they sign. And I'm talking about issues of the interest rate that you're going to be paying for, how long and how it will accrue. And in the event that you're not meeting the time or paying the money monthly, making your monthly contributions, what would happen to your interest, okay? All that is what we want to share with you this week with the Chief Finance Officer of Vision Group, Tamale Augustine, who tells us what you need to know about a loan. And what's good, though, is it is actually good to take a loan as long as you use the loan for what is productive. This is Personal Finance Management Tips.
Hello, viewer. Augustine Tamale are my names. I'm the Chief Finance Officer of Vision Group. A loan is an amount of money an individual organization borrows from another. So it's money you receive and you're supposed to pay it back in the agreed period. It could be interest-free, it could have interest on it. So that varies, because it could be between siblings and your brother has lent you money and you just return the 1 million you've been lent. But in other instances, especially for commercial entities, you have to add a profit, because they are into the business of lending and making a profit from that venture. So when you borrow money, that money borrowed is the loan. Taking a loan depends on two factors. One, the purpose of the borrowing. It could be a medical emergency. I would accept if you're saving your life or somebody's life, you can take a loan. It could be improving your financial or economic situation, that is increasing your income or reducing on your costs. So if you're taking a loan to set up your own house such that you avoid paying rent, that's great. If you're taking a loan to start a business or to increase the capital or stock in your business such that you have more income, that is okay. So if you are borrowing in those areas, I accept you can borrow. But if you are borrowing for social reasons, you want to buy a suit, you want to marry, no. So I don't believe taking a loan for a wedding, taking a loan to improve your clothes, that is sensible. It's not at all. A loan should either be medical emergency or financial improvement. There, I advise you can take a loan. However, you need to consider an additional factor, whether taking it is better than saving, because probably you are going to buy something that you could have saved for in the next couple of months. Then you don't need a loan. Yeah, you don't need a loan. But if taking the loan helps you to buy that item at a cheaper cost, like land, then that's okay as well. Although you can save over years and you buy land, but if at all the price of land will have tripled by the time you complete the saving, then it's okay to take the loan. It's very fine. When you're going to take a loan, you should review whether you have monthly income or regular income, because some people earn quarterly, others annually. So you should check whether you have income, because you will pay back the loan using your regular income. So that is the first thing. Anybody who has no income shouldn't borrow. That one needs aid. Either is just starting a business, should be given aid. Someone donates capital to you. But if you're starting a business and you're starting it purely on a loan capital, you are in trouble, because there are many parameters you are assuming will remain constant. Should they change? A bad debt and liquidation of your assets. So you should have regular income. The second thing you should consider is your fallback position. Supposing your regular income gets a problem, what will you do to pay off this loan? So it should be that in your mind you are aware that I'm borrowing to build a house. Should things go bad, I lose my job, either through layoff of employees when there is trouble, or a business, you're running your business and it collapses, but then I can sell this land and house, pay off the loan, and remain with some money to set up a smaller home. So you should have a plan B, that if this doesn't work, I have a certain piece of land I've reserved, I can liquidate. There should always be a plan B, because this world is full of surprises. The other thing are the terms of the loan. Look through The problem we have, people are in a hurry. When someone wants to borrow, they just want to see the amount and sign off. That's what they want to see. Instead of looking through the terms, does the loan have an early settlement option? Does the loan have a buy-off option? Because if that is absent, you are going to carry the loan through to its full term. And usually, you pay a lot of money. A mortgage of about 300 million shillings, if you service it for 15 years, you pay over a billion shillings in interest. Now, you can save money such that within 5-7 years, you settle that loan earlier, although you've been paying monthly. So that will save you not to pay the entire billion. So does your loan have an early settlement? That is very key.
So we just thought we could run a couple of episodes, and so there'll be I think 2, 3 or 4, yeah, on how you can understand more about loans. So we'll be telling you in the subsequent weeks some of the things that indicate that your loan is doing okay, and or probably why you need to restructure. Also the indicators that your loan needs to be worked on so you do not go off your financial goals. Okay. Let's talk the Forex then and money market report. The shilling has been what? Relatively stable, about 3.7-ish for the week opening Monday. It starts now. Let's see what the markets look like in a comprehensive report. Well, I guess I have to go now. For a business person, what can you do to keep making money? Complaining won't take you so far, so try do something that will work out for you. I just thought I would say shout outs to UNBS. Yes, there was a whole story of where you are trying to decentralize services, certification services. I just thought it's a good thing because we do not have to see all the processors come from across the country to UNBS here in Kampala to have the certification done. So we can hope that the different food processors can take advantage of these opportunities so we can have standards, you know, fully followed in this country. That's it for this week. My name is Simon. I'll see you soon from me and the team. Bye-bye.